We saw Governor Dayton make a play to try to unionize the daycare workers. And this made me so angry, because what he did by executive order was to call for an election of only the daycare providers that were receiving subsidies from the state of Minnesota. So if there are 11,000 daycare workers, he says, all right, I'm going to decide by executive order that you guys get to vote on this. Only all of you don't get to vote, just the 4,000 of the 11,000 total get to vote and decide if you want to be the if you want to be unionized. How unfair was that?
You know, it was a very unfair and really an engineered approach to voting, which I think I sense Minnesotans are flatly rejecting that. There's a huge amount of outrage. And Sue, that is part of the fuel, I think, behind what Minnesotans are saying in these polling results we're seeing around freedom of employment. They are rejecting the notion of forced unionization that says, you know what, if you work here, you have to join a union or you're fired. That's basically what we have now. If you don't join this union, you either can't be employed or you're fired. And that's what we have. Minnesotans reject that. And I think that as they see this initiative coming forward from the governor, they're getting a taste of what we have. And they don't like the anti-freedom component of it. And so I think it's really playing in the hands of freedom and free-loving Minnesotans.
I do too. And it helped that the judge told Governor Dayton, yeah, you don't get to do that. You overstepped your authority. You abused your authority. And I hope the legislature will do something to try to protect them. Or maybe the right to work or the freedom of employment, maybe that will take care of that. Will it eliminate Dayton's ability to authorize union votes by executive order?
It won't affect that. That'll happen independently, but should that be successful and should they hold a vote and should the 4,000 daycare workers out of the 11,000 that have been selected vote to have the union and that's successful, of those 4,000 workers then, business owners,
yes,
would at that point have the freedom to decide whether they want to join the union. If freedom of employment or right to work wouldn't be there, which it is not now, they would be forced to join the union against their will, to pay money to this union against their will, and essentially decrease their take-home pay or their disposable income, which is not what we want to have happen.
Right. And if the governor could come in and determine by executive orders that the daycare workers who were receiving subsidies could vote on becoming members of the union, while the other daycare providers couldn't, what group of people would he pick next?
Where is he going next?
Right.
Exactly.
It could be home health care workers. It could be doctors. It could be
construction
anything.
Business workers. Who knows? Yeah, exactly. That's why it's heartening to see that the judge, as you mentioned, has seen the light of day here. And
crushed it.
Well, okay.
He didn't crush it. It was a temporary restraining order.
The governor did not have anything to stand on to begin with, and he's been called out, and the emperor has no clothes at this point.
Yeah. Unfortunately, our attorney general decided to jump on board, and they are going to go through with the appeal with the hearing that's coming up in January of next year. So that'll be interesting.
I anticipate we're going to see freedom of employment polls come close to 80% at that point, Sue.
It's encouraging to see you guys working on legislation like that. You look on the other hand, you've got Mark Dayton making a task force to study obesity, a task force to study bullying, a task force to study health insurance exchanges, a task force to study all these ridiculous things instead of letting the legislature do their job.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are going to do our job, and as I mentioned, there's going to be a variety of reforms coming forward. It's going to be a fun session, a good session for those of us that are liberty-minded, and it's going to be probably the first opportunity really in many, many years, 38 years since we've controlled the Minnesota State Senate, since Republicans have controlled the Minnesota State Senate. So it's going to be really the first real display of bills and legislative activity that is going to be geared toward actually reclaiming some of our freedoms instead of the incremental reduction of freedoms that we've seen over many of the past decades.
And just so you know, coming up in the next election, we're going to work real hard to get more conservatives and libertarians elected so that we can get some of this stuff done, because people in Minnesota know that government is too big, too expensive, and too intrusive, and we just have to stop.
It is, and they do know that what we run into, and sometimes I see as a legislator, sometimes it's the resistance, if you will, to some of these measures is greater in government than it is from the other party. I mean, a lot of times you are, you know, the old thing about fighting City Hall, it's amazing. These government bureaucracies are dug in, and they have instant credibility in the discussions in the hearings because they know their area so well, and they bring that to the table. But they continue to fight our ability to bring about reforms, the same reforms that Minnesotans are asking us to bring. But we're steadfast in our effort to do so, and we'll continue on that path.
We're down to our last minute now, and I want you to look into the cameras, and I want you to tell people why the Freedom of Employment Act is going to be so important, why we want to see it on the ballot, and why we're going to support it.
Well, what we have is in Minnesota, we have a situation where we have compulsory or forced union membership. And that means if anybody in Minnesota decides to or is hired by a firm or a government bureaucracy that is unionized, they are required to be a part of that union. And that means they have to give up those union dues, which can be hundreds of dollars. I mean, we're talking about teachers, $750, $800 a year that is taken against their will by unions many times for the union bosses to use in elections and other things that is not part of the mission of the union. So this freedom of employment will give the employee the freedom to decide whether they want to be a member, whether they want to pay those dues or not. And that's the freedom we have in 22 other states in the U.S. It will help us bring forward economic prosperity. It will help job creation grow by a rate of twice of what it is now and has historically in our state. And this is the type of measure we need to bring forward to bring jobs back, to get the 200,000 Minnesotans that currently don't have a job back to be employed again.
We are out of time. If you find yourself agreeing with our guest, you might be a libertarian. To find out, take the world's smallest quiz at www.theadvocates.org. Remember, Libertarian Viewpoint brings you the non-government, liberty-based solutions that other media refuse to tell you about. Liberty works, and it is always the best choice. If anyone in government can prove otherwise, I challenge them to speak up. To view past shows, search YouTube using Libertarian Viewpoint. Thank you for watching and stay tuned for other shows of Libertarian Viewpoint. Freedom of employment, does it really exist?